Vande Bharat continues to be the talk of the town across the country, and especially in Kerala, we have the master brain behind Vande Bharat, Mr. Sudhanshu Mani sir with us, joining for Dialogues. Sir, you have been seeing your dream spreading happiness across the country since 2018, but in Kerala, the inauguration was really literally a celebration. So what was your feeling when you saw all those moments?
Of course, the feeling is one of wonder and great satisfaction. As you said, yes, the train has been received very well all across India. But I think Kerala is special because, of course, first of all, it's the most literate state. So arrival of this train definitely means that people are looking forward to cutting down travel time. And that I think is one reason of excitement. Another reason, as I said, it's a state where people are aware of things, and they view it as a product which is made by Indians for India, a symbol of resurgent India, and that's why I think they love it, almost as if it is a spacecraft, as you said. It's just a train, but the people of Kerala have really showered their love on this train.
So when you designed Vande Bharat, speed is expected to be 180 km per hour, but in Kerala, it is limited to 110 due to various reasons. In order to really attain the real speed, what we have to do very soon?
When the train was designed, we designed it for 160 km per hour operation, and we tested it at 180 km per hour. But we don't have such tracks except between Delhi and Bhopal, one stretch. Rest is mostly 130 and in some places 110, as you are saying in Kerala. Now, although it is not being run at its full potential and it is awaiting track upgrade to do that, still, because it's packed with very fast acceleration and deceleration, because it's aesthetically superior and has more passenger amenities, it's being received well. So to answer your question, at 110 itself, it will give the passengers a new travel experience, cut down travel time. But full exploitation of potential would come as the track is upgraded, which is easier in other parts of the country, not so easy in Kerala, because as you know, there are many curves and grades. But within that constraint, it should be able to cut down 15% of the travel time.
Sir, in your 38 years of experience in railway, what do you think should be the strategy change that we must adopt as early as possible in order to make all our project happen very soon? That we announce each government, or whether it be state government or central government, every government announce new projects, but it takes so long time. So by then, when it is achieved, the technology must have updated or the scenario must have changed. So what should we do in order to make our projects happen as early as possible?
Okay, good question. So when we made the train, we were showing to India and the world that we are ready with a 160 kilometers per hour train. We were expecting the track upgradation to keep pace, which has not happened. To that extent, it's not a chicken and egg story, but definitely upgrade on track should be bigger priority now. A large number of trains are going to be made, and it would be good if the government spends more money on track upgrade, and it will give double benefit. First of all, the trains would run it to its full potential. It will increase line capacity. It will cut down travel time. So I would think that, yes, more and more upgradation of track should be a focus now. Sometimes it may not be so easy. It is expensive. For example, in Kerala itself, easing of the curves is not going to be so easy. Maybe in some places, but mostly it will not be possible because it will be a massive change of alignment and things like that. But whatever possible must be done quickly. At this point, even that much has not been done at the pace that I would think should have been done.
Should government and railway consider first viability of railway tracks, or should we move on to some other new projects? So what is more viable for us?
It has to keep at least 50 years in mind. You see, a simple thing, for example, a train. The life of a train today is 35 to 40 years. So once you make a project, in a railway situation, then you have a train which will be with you for 30 to 40 years. So you have to take a very, very long-term view. And the fixed installations also caused a lot of money, and you cannot take a short-term view. So that's very clear. It has to be a very, very long-term view. We are a democracy, so people's aspirations, people's problems cannot be ignored. But if the government goes with empathy, I don't think it's such a challenge. After all, as I said, there are projects where things have been done at a very rapid pace. After all, you would remember Mr. E. Sridharan when he built the Delhi Metro. It was an amazing speed. And some of the other metros have also been built at a very good speed because of the example set by Mr. Sridharan. So projects can proceed at very good speed in India also. The government has to have that commitment, that empathy, and that sense of purpose. It's possible, absolutely possible.
So still in India, we are talking about semi and high-speed trains only. When can India dream about a bullet train? When competing with the global world, what do you think? Have we attained a commendable growth in our rail development, or do we have to make more measures in order to compete with the world-class level?
Yes, so first for bullet train, you see, we had been debating about it for 20, 25 years. Today, except USA and Australia, there is no other developed country or even medium level country which is not going for high speed rail. So, but we were debating all this time whether it will be worth it, whether it is going to be beneficial in India. We have this kind of socio-economic milieu and so on. But the present government decided to take it forward. And my view is also this, that we should first build 2-3 such lines. We are a large country. We cannot just be an exception in this world. Build 2-3 lines and learn for yourself whether it is beneficial or not. No harm. It's not going to be a great waste, certainly. So I would say that Mumbai, Ahmedabad and couple more sections, let's say Chennai, Bangalore, something like that, should be built and built fast. And then we should seriously evaluate whether it is worth it. Because you see, once you have this high-speed rail, for example, between Mumbai and Ahmedabad, it will totally kill air traffic there. The trains are more comfortable. They land you in the center of the city. So I've seen it in West. For example, Frankfurt to Cologne. Once I got a ticket of Lufthansa, I went to airport. I was told it's a train ticket. So there's no air traffic between the two cities.
So in general, a common man takes or opts railway journey considering the economical profit or the power between airfares. So do you think that if we make more expensive trains or which are more expensive in comfort and luxury, will Indians be ready to opt that or will they move away? What is your take? Will expense or the high cost affect the people more coming into railway?
Railways compared to roads and aircrafts is 6 to 8 times cleaner and greener. So it is also good for the Mother Earth that we have more and more trains. Remember that. So it's not just travel time. Also, as you said, more comfort. Trains inherently are more comfortable compared to bus and aircraft. You'll agree. I mean, you have more space to walk around, a little bit more space to yourself. So given that, yes, I'm a votary for more and more trains, not only bullet trains, but also trains like Vande Bharat running at 160 kilometers per hour or even higher in future on existing tracks. If they will not kill air traffic, they will give a very healthy competition to air traffic. And it will be good for the country as a whole because, as I said, it is environmentally better to run more railways.
Sir, I have heard you saying many times that success stories have to be discussed, but failures have to be more discussed. So tell us about the whole journey that your dream started when dreaming a high-speed train for India.
Yeah, from my own story, I tell youth that, you see, usually we tell young people that you should live your dream, go after your dream, chase your dream. I will modify it a little. You see, in life, you have to take care of your bread and butter. You'll have a family, you have to take care of your family. So that's primary. First, look after yourself and your family. But make sure that that dream, that passion you have for doing something out of the box, let it not die when you take care of your family and yourself. Let it linger. It should not be extinguished. And I'm sure sooner or later, an opportunity will present itself to you where it'll give you an opportunity to realize your dream. In my case, in this train story, that's what happened. I had this angst and this dream that why does India not have a better looking, aesthetically superior, speedier, technologically superior train? And I was also in the rut in the railway service for so long. But I got an opportunity to lead the biggest factory in the world. So that was an opportunity. And the opportunity of a very competent team of staff and engineers bequeathed to me. I did nothing about it. What an opportunity. And at that time, it was my job to channelize this energy and realize my dream. So you can say I waited for so long, but that opportunity presented itself and I was able to make good of it. So my advice to youth would be, don't live in your dream, but let that dream linger and wait for the opportunity for you to realize.
So how important is to maintain a good healthy relationship among the bureaucrats, among the workers, among the laymen, so as to make each and every project more successful?
We have to break this shackle of boundaries, bureaucracy, hierarchy, walls between people. This was something we have acquired from the British, a foreign power governing Indians. So they had their own set of rules. We have not broken free of this colonial mentality yet. Although everyone there is a compatriot, an Indian. GM to downwards the lowest staff have no walls in between. They are free to interact. And that's very, very much necessary in 21st century for your human resource to be with you. It can give you wonders. People will perform 110, 120% more than their capability if they have this kind of atmosphere. So I think we were able to change things in ICF. I hope it is still continuing. This colonial culture that we have in government, not only railways, must go. Otherwise, we will never become a developed country. It has to go.
Sir, there is a general trend among our youth that they are migrating from our country in order to make their dreams happen or fulfill their dream. Why is it happening? And what is the advice that you have to give to our authorities to retain them, like to preserve our human resource, especially youth, and to make their ideas executed in our country and make benefit?
Right. So it's the ecosystem. That ecosystem does not reward innovative spirit today. It does not really reward entrepreneurial new experiments and so on. We are a large country. Things are changing. They should change more rapidly. None of these people who migrate simply because they want to go abroad. They have a dream. They have a passion to do something, and they find it won't be greatly supported in the country, so they go abroad. Some of them go simply because of a better life, I don't deny that. But once we build an ecosystem where the spirit of this youth is rewarded, I'm sure migrations will stop. And in any case, India is on a growth path, and very soon we will be a larger economy, much larger economy that we are. It will present many opportunities. But the underlying sentiment that I think have is this spirit of doing your own, pride of doing your own with ownership. That has to be rewarded. The ecosystem must encourage it so that youth have this incentive to stay back in the country and do something for themselves and in the process for the country.
Kerala government has proposed KRL project, but the main issue that is facing is the compensation of land and land acquisition. So what would be your one piece of advice to a Kerala government in order to make K-Rail happen, or what would be your opinion about whether K-Rail is sustainable for Kerala, and will that be beneficial more to the future?
Government needs empathy and good compensation. I'll give you an example. For example, high-speed railways between Mumbai and Ahmedabad. While the land acquisition went on a very good pace in Gujarat, it did not happen in Maharashtra. Because the government at that time, the Aghadi government, did not have its heart in it. Once the government changed, land acquisition has progressed satisfactorily. That means the government also has to understand the problem of people and try to find a solution with empathy. That's the larger question. In respect of Silver Line project, I have one view about all RRTS or similar projects in the country. You see, the RRTS is being proposed in broad, in standard gauge. I have not understood the reason for that. Because the train which the Prime Minister himself launches, this is the 15th launch today, has the stamp of the Prime Minister. That is in broad gauge. So what is the benefit of making a new line in standard gauge? I would think it should be made in broad gauge, and it should be aligned or should be a part of the existing system as far as possible. And wherever the curvature has to be eased much more than possible in existing line, you can take a bypass and make a new line. This is a broad observation that I'm making. I'm not fully aware of the details of the project. But the very basic issue of making these in standard gauge is something I don't understand anymore, because the trains are there in broad gauge. What benefit are we going to get by making it in standard gauge? Broad gauge means you will be able to integrate it with the existing lines also. Maybe outside stations you take a different route, but entry to the station through existing lines and so many benefits, it will bring down the cost also. So my view is this, such kinds of all rail projects, you know, 160 kilometers per hour rapid rail project should be done in broad gauge.
It's a very hypothetical question, I know, but still I'm attempting. If Kerala government invites you for a collaboration or for an advice for the K-Rail project, will you be joining hands with us?
No. First of all, one of the things that I decided after retirement was to generally keep away from government, because I like my freedom of speech. I like to write, I like to speak, and I like to speak my mind. In a government situation, you are not supposed to do it. There is a protocol, there is a propriety. So generally, I thought it will be good for me. Not that some great assignment was offered to me, but it's not sour grapes. I have enjoyed my freedom of writing and speaking. So whether it's Kerala government or any other government, I'll have to think 100 times before aligning myself with any project like this. I do consult with private industry, and that too on a limited basis, not a full time. But as an advisor, and to advise them, even if it is not a paid assignment, I'll be very, very happy to do that, because I like such projects. So a hypothetical question, definitely, but hypothetical answer that I'll be willing to advise them for whatever it's worth, but not in any assignment.
It was really nice talking to you, and hope one day you'll come to Kerala and have a Vande Bharat journey in Kerala.
Absolutely. I would love that, and I must say in three words, thank you, Kerala.
Thank you.